a thing of trying to, you know, get certain agencies. And since I've been working with them, I've done phone downloads. I've done phone downloads for the ATF on a shooting case we had, I don't know, 6 years ago. But I've also done it for Erie, Fort Lupton, Meade, all of Tri-Town. I've done it for Platteville. So I've done phone downloads for several different agencies as well to help progress those crimes in a quicker manner.
And so the informal agreement that we've been operating on, one of the things we essentially did is go to these agents with the Secret Service and say, does this provide a real benefit for our agency, or are we just going to be an extra tool for this task force to utilize in this area? And we found with an overwhelming amount of success that this is a direct benefit to the citizens here. And two cases that have been filed that I can speak to a little in more detail involve kind of a regional group effort, but real impact to people that live and work or visit Dacono. The first was a simple motor vehicle theft that was reported. Officer did an excellent job with the initial report that led to Wyoming law enforcement officials getting involved, arresting a guy that was, of course, involved with numerous other criminal activity, because that's how stolen vehicle cases generally work. And the Drug Enforcement Administration got involved in that Wyoming case because of a drug component. And in the midst of that, they seized 10 electronic devices, including cell phones, thumb drives, and a hard drive. And the Drug Enforcement Agency and all of their resources in their lab were unsuccessful in downloading those 10 devices. We got involved, partnered with the Jefferson County Sheriff's Office, who requested our assistance, and specifically because of what Sergeant Lambert can do and what this task force can do. And the Secret Service took those same 10 devices. I coordinated the movement from Wyoming to Colorado to get them to the Denver lab. And in those 10 devices, they were able to recover 8,657 data files containing 663 gigabytes of data. Now, I'm not privy to exactly how all that data tied into the criminal network, but what ended up happening with this case is, in 2022, the Colorado statewide grand jury presented a 90-count indictment on 5 individuals that ended a crime spree that began in December 2019, ran through March of 2021. Dacono was a small blip in that crime spree, but that victim, as I said before, deserves to be represented with the same level of service as they would get anywhere else. And because of this investigation, they were able to be represented in that case filing. And even though we're talking about something like a stolen vehicle that, frankly, insurance probably paid for, they at least had that representation and had some avenue of restitution in that case. The other case involves an elderly citizen who fell victim to a cryptocurrency scam involving these ATMs that you might have seen at some of these retail establishments that turn cash into things like Bitcoin. Bitcoin is the one that was used in this case. We got this report, and frankly, I don't do anything with cryptocurrency personally, and I had never investigated a case professionally involving cryptocurrency scams. So without resources, the typical police response would be, we're not equipped to handle that, we'll let a federal agency know, and you may or may not hear from somebody. Instead, we went to the Secret Service and I said, I need help with this, I don't know where to start, but we want to represent this victim. They were able to help me learn about cryptocurrency and how it works and how the transactions are stored, and also identify suspect accounts and where those accounts are held. And what we learned, and I'll read a little bit from here because I don't want to mess up the numbers here, but what we learned was, again, organized crime is likely involved here, moving money from different shell accounts and eventually resulting in about $5,500 per day leaving the United States to go overseas internationally to these suspects. So that's about $2 million a year just in what we were able to identify. Now, that led to us going to Weld County, and from the district attorney, I was informed, to their knowledge, this was the first ever production of records for cryptocurrency accounts that was put forth through Weld County, and we sent it off to the cryptocurrency place called Bittrex. It's a U.S.-based company that manages these accounts for U.S. consumers, and we were able to obtain some data, which ultimately led to turning the investigation back over to Homeland Security and the Secret Service to continue. But again, we have an elderly Dacono resident who is now represented in this large federal case because of these relationships that we've established. I reiterated on it a few times. I believe we're extremely competent here at the Dacono Police Department, our digital forensic program. The majority of that credit goes to Sergeant Lambert. But establishing this relationship takes it beyond our individual agency capacities and just it makes us part of a network that is a lot more powerful than what we currently have to offer. The Secret Service has been generous enough to continue an informal relationship with us, but we really do need to formalize the agreement if we want to continue using those resources, and we have every intent of doing that, but it's not possible without signing the memorandum of understanding between these two agencies. So with that, I'll close. Again, reiterate, no direct cost to the city. It actually provides a potential financial benefit in addition to the investigative benefit. And I'm happy to answer any questions within reason that I can to elaborate on how it's helped with investigations.
Thank you, Detective. Any questions from council?
Is there an argument against this? I'm having a hard time figuring out why somebody wouldn't approve this, but...
The only argument that I have heard addressed is that if it were to come with a cost, that would be a consideration. But again, we've affirmed multiple times, and it's plainly written in the agreement that it comes with no cost to the city.
Okay. I would say the the other argument is how much are we supposed to give to the Secret Service as part of being part of this? We're already a small police force, and staffing's low in every police force. So will this agreement pull resources away from Dacono to help with Secret Service stuff? Luckily, there's well over 50 plus members in this task force. And so if I can't help somebody, I can transfer them to the next one. Or if we're too short-staffed to do something, I have an ability to do it. So that would be the only other argument I see. And so far, in the 5 years I've done it, that's never been an issue.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else from council? I move to approve resolution 2368 approving a memorandum of understanding with United States Secret Service.
I second.
Get a vote, please.
Kevin Plain?
Yes.
Danny Long? Yeah. Doris Crespo?
Yes.
Michelle Rogers?
Yes.
Resolution 2368 approved with all council voting yes. Kathleen, we'd be going 3 hours here if someone needed to take a break for 5 minutes, or how would that work?
That's within your prerogative as the presiding officer,
would
Mayor.
Would we stay on the record, or would we just log off and then I'd?
Yes.
Okay, stay on the record then. Anybody need a break?
Yes, I need a break.
Okay. Thank you. We're going to take a 3 or 4 minute break here.
Okay.
I just need to rest my eyes a little bit. My eyes are dry.
Well, I forgot my quill from the car. I have degenerative disc disease.
Yeah.
I didn't. Where's mine? Oh.
It's downright chilly in here.
It is. I'm freezing.
I'll give you the one that has less drank out of it. It's got less cooties.
Yeah. It's probably mine anyways.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. True.
Well, the good thing is when we go out there, we'll have like this force field. Of
yeah, I grabbed it. That was my bad. I thought
it's okay.
I left it there, but I left it. Okay. Council's back. So if I can. So part of our code requires if we go past 8:30, we need to have a vote of council to continue, or we have to, as a group, decide to table it to another meeting. I would move that we continue this meeting at this point until we're completed. Do I have a second?
Yeah, second.
Nice.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Can you vote, please, Lisa?
Danny Long?
Yes.
Doris Crespo?
Yes.
Michelle Rogers?
Yes.
Kevin Plain?
Yes.
Okay, meeting is continued past the 8:30 mark with a vote of council. So we're on to discussion of city manager recruitment services RFP.
Very good. Thank you, Mayor. I will be quick. Last week, I sent all of you the city manager recruitment RFP in advance. And what I wanted to do this evening was to see if there were any questions or feedback regarding that. There are two dates that we need to make some decisions on with respect to a study session to review the RFP response, and then some dates to interview firms. Again, this request for proposals is to hire a public sector executive recruitment firm to lead your city manager recruitment process. So with that, are there any questions or comments on the RFP that I can address?
I thought it was pretty comprehensive. I didn't see a whole lot of holes in it. And to be honest with you, I know we were trying to be brief, but I know we have to kind of move in an order on this, but if we don't get a ton at first, can we extend that date if we feel that is necessary?
Sure, absolutely. Just to let you know, I have 17 firms that we'll be sending this RFP to directly that specialize in public sector executive recruitment.
Okay.
So I'm sure within that group we will receive a decent amount of responses, but we'll also post it on our city website. And my sense is word is on the street that the city of Dacono is moving forward in hiring a permanent city manager. So there'll be interest.
What's the next date you want to shoot for? I think you had it in the packet.
So the next thing I'd like to do is just maybe lock up a study session date for council to come together and review these RFPs. We will send them to you after the closing date, so you'll have some time to review them on your own, but to come together as a group and select the firms that you would like to interview. I would like to propose that maybe something around the week of August 21st or 25th as a date, if something in there will work.
What days of the week are those?
Well, it's a Monday, Tuesday. Monday would be the 21st. The 22nd would be a Tuesday, if any of those might work.
Letting people check their schedules.
Okay.
Tuesday the 22nd, you said?
That's an option. Or you tell me. You'll probably have a long council meeting again on the 14th. I don't anticipate Planning Commission on the 15th. That's another date you could look at in August. It's really the pleasure of the council.
I'm open to any days. I'll make it if I can by any means possible.
21st, 22nd is fine with me.
Okay. Can we shoot for the 21st? Is that all right? Okay. So we will have a... Oh, yeah, thank you, Councilman Long. All right, so we'll shoot for August 21st to meet and review proposals. And then with respect to actually interviewing firms, this would be a September date. And I think it's important just, again, to give ample notice to any potential responder to the RFP when they could expect. I anticipate, since most of these firms are out of state, this will be by Zoom. And if we could have two nights, if you find that you only want to interview three firms, it might be all done in one night. If you find that there's, five, six that you like, then we would obviously want to break it into two
evenings. So I would propose looking at the week of September 12th, 13th, or September 13th, 14th. You have a meeting on September 11th, so this would be Tuesday the 12th and 13th, or you could go into the following week. My only concern is ideally it would be nice for you to have a firm on board by the end of September. But if you're okay with extending a contract into October, that gives you a little bit more flexibility too. It's really, again, how fast you want to move on the recruitment.
I'm open those days in September, so that's fine. They're evenings anyway, so.
I'm good the 11th or the 13th.
Okay, well, the 11th, you already have a council meeting. Could you do the 12th and the 13th, which would be Tuesday and Wednesday evening?
I cannot do the 12th.
Okay.
Sorry. I might be out of town that week.
Okay. Would you like to go into the following week and look at the 18th
and
19th?
It would be perfect if we could. I will not be here in person that week. If I can participate in Zoom, I can do that.
Okay. Well, they would be Zoom interviews most likely anyway, so it would be fine. Okay, so 18th and 19th, two interview firms.
Sure.
I think that works.
All right. I will insert these dates, and we will get this out the door this week. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Next up is discussion of proposed home rule charter amendments and other potential ballot questions for the November 7th, 2023 election.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. Mayor and council members, as you know, we have an election coming up in November, and this is the time of year that the city council generally considers whether to propose any amendments to the city's home rule charter. If you decide to refer any amendments, they are referred by ordinance, which is why we have to plan pretty far in advance. An ordinance requires two readings. There's a public hearing on the second reading of the ordinance, and then the ballot language is certified to the Weld County Clerk and Recorder Elections Division in early September. So you would have, you need to have first reading of an ordinance at your first August meeting and second reading at your second August meeting so that it becomes effective in time to certify the ballot. I put together a list of proposed amendments for you to review. I've gotten input on these from Councilmember Plain. I also sent these to Mayor Pro Tem Whitman, who under the charter as the Mayor Pro Tem has some responsibilities in terms of charter amendments. And I did, and she's not here tonight, but I'll tell you, I did receive a response back from her, not on any of these proposed amendments, but she addressed term limitations, and it was her position that the term limitations remain as they are in the charter. That's not an amendment that's proposed for you this evening, so I just offer you that as the response that I received from Mayor Pro Tem Whitman. This is for your discussion and direction tonight, and again, these are your ordinances that will refer to your voters. This is proposed to you, but it is your decision on what to refer to the voters or whether to refer anything at all to the voters. If there's anything that you would like to discuss that isn't in this list, I'm happy to draft up some proposed language. I would need to know that shortly because, again, first reading of the ordinance would be at your next council meeting.
So, you know, not everybody knows the charter, you know, front to back. Could we kind of go through or is that our intent tonight to kind of go through some of these and just pull out the deltas? What would be changing that we would have to, you know, we would want to see voters decide on, or maybe we don't even propose some of these things if we.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. It's for your discussion. I just have prepared this for your use.
Yeah. So do you want to lead the discussion, or should we just kind of go through it? How do we do that, Mayor?
However you would like.
I can lead it. I was just pulling it up. I had to scroll down a little bit. So starts with Section 1.6, Open Government Policy. To me, these all seem pretty common sense. Each council member and each member of a permanent board or commission shall participate in at least one city-sponsored open government-related seminar, workshop, or other program at least once every 2 years. Such program shall provide information on at least the following topics relating to municipal government: the theories and policies underlying the laws relating to ethics, open government, open meetings, open records, and promoting citizen participation in municipal government. B, the city shall publish and periodically update as necessary a summary of the laws governing open meetings, and such summary shall be provided to each council member and at each member of a permanent board or commission and post on the city's website. And I think that's what we received tonight. This was a...
Well, it looks like a first taste of it.
Yeah.
But yeah, this is new. This is saying, look, let's make it a requirement that members of boards and commissions and council members not only get training, but they must get training.
Section 1.7, it's just definition. First part A is a definition. Just says public body means the council, city council, any board, committee, commission, authority, or other advisories, policy-making, rule-making, or formally constituted body of the city. And meeting means any kind of gathering convened to discuss public business in person, by telephone, electronically, or by other means of communication. All meetings are, this is already kind of in there, I think, all meetings are a quorum of three or more members of any public body, whichever is fewer, and all meetings of two or more members of any public body with one or more elected or appointed official of another governmental entity at which city business is discussed or at which any formal action may be taken shall be at public meetings open to the public at all times. So that one's new.
Yeah, and Mayor, so yeah, we should stop right there on that one. So just to clarify for everybody, it's always been, you know, three or more is a public meeting and needs to be noticed. What this adds is, and Kathleen, make sure I understand this, interpret this right, what we're saying here is two Dacono board members, council or whatever, or commission or whatever, two plus another person from another governmental entity, another elected person or appointed official. Because at that point, you got three people. They're obviously there to discuss things that are pertinent to Dacono, and the public has a right to know that something's being discussed. So if people want to go to that public meeting, it's going to be a public meeting anyway. It's just that we're going to notice it so that people are aware. And
that's right, and it's only when city business is being discussed.
Right, right. Now, question though, because in the section above, it talks about any means, whether electronic, telephone, whatever, right? In this case, I worry a little bit. I have a worry because let's say that member of that other governmental entity sends an email to the entire city council. Mm-hmm. Suddenly, that just invoked this, right? And that elected official wouldn't know that we have this special rule that other cities and towns don't have.
Remember, there's a proximity in time to establish a meeting by email, and that's why, you know, you're often reminded, don't reply all when an email is sent to the city council. Okay. So if an elected official from another entity emails the entire council, you would follow the same.
We wouldn't all respond to it.
You wouldn't reply all if you had a response.
Okay, I just want to clarify that because it popped into my head this morning when walking the dog.
The other thing that's different from the state open meetings law is Section 1-7E about substantive discussion of items that aren't on the agenda. The case law under the open meetings law suggests that, you know, the public has a right to know what you're going to talk about and act on. And there's a lot of gray area. And so this, under the case law, so this provision in your charter would make it clear that in the city of Dacono, that each public body would only talk about and only take action on what's on the agenda, so that your public knows when they look at the agenda what you're going to be considering for action.
Right, and that could be ordinances, resolutions, or motions to approve something or appoint somebody to some commission or send somebody somewhere.
Correct, or even just discussion direction of a topic. You know, it doesn't have to be a formal action.
So it doesn't force everything to be an ordinance or a resolution.
No, it does not.
So you could have substantive discussions, but you couldn't take it formal action. I understand what you're saying.
You would not have substantive discussion if it's not on the agenda.
It may not.
Yeah. Under this, I mean, however, again, this is your
Yeah. So I did have another concern on this one, which is staff reports, council reports, sometimes who knows what might come up during those reports. And that could turn into something that's substantive. So how do we deal with that?
You say, wow, that sounds like a good topic to discuss. Let's put it on the agenda for the next meeting.
Okay. Because I remember back last year, you know, I asked the council, hey, you know, I'd like to meet with somebody or get something rolling on charter schools. And I asked the council for their blessing and permission during council reports. And everybody said, yeah, that sounds like a good idea. And so Kathy and I went out and we talked to a guy, right, and then brought that report back to council. So would that be permitted?
Yeah, that's not a council decision. Okay. I mean, it's...
All right. So I just want to make sure that's understood. We're not putting a straitjacket on it.
Jen would just have to be more prepared, you know, if there's anything that's going to be, she thinks, discussed, she would have to put that on the agenda if she thought it would have substantive discussions then.
All right.
Any questions from council about that? Or issues?
Yeah, I think we should take this back and think about it. Every person should read this very closely and carefully. I mean, are we ready to talk about the next one? Because I see the next one's right there.
1-8.
Yeah.
Transparency and required disclosure of city council funds at transparency regarding the source of information provided to the council and other boards and commissions of the city is essential to good decision-making and upholding the public trust. Each person who appears before the council, a board, or commission of the city who is a relative of the member of such body shall disclose such relationship at the time of such appearance. The mayor, each council member, and each member of city board or commission has an affirmative duty to inform the council, board, or commission when they have personal knowledge that the person appearing before them is a relative of a member of such body. If such relationship is not disclosed by the person appearing before them, for purposes of this section, relative shall have the same meeting as set forth in section 2-7F of this charter.
Yeah, I can see all kinds
of
applications of this, but the one that pops into my mind would be somebody during a public hearing giving public testimony. We're talking testimony, right, on a land use matter. I think it makes it seem right that if that person speaking and giving testimony is a relative of somebody on this council, that should be disclosed.
Yes, it should.
That's just one example.
So here's another change, too. I think this is a good change. So did I read? Hang on a second. So this is still part of this amendment. So we go down to vacancies, which just says that no relative of the council member or the mayor be appointed to fill a vacancy in the council. And it has.
And that's existing language, Mayor.
Correct.
That's already in your charter.
Correct. It just defined relative better.
Right. Yeah, the underlined is the new text.
The definition. The last part of this first one is special meetings and businesses of special meeting and business has special meetings. Special meetings shall be called by the city clerk on the written request of the mayor or any two council members. Special meetings shall be held at least 48 hours written notice to each elected official served personally. And so what takes out, what would strike is left at the official's usual place of residence, and it would sub in sending it to our email. So we wouldn't have to have the personal service, and email would then suffice as notice of the meeting. I think it's less issues with staff having to go out to our houses and do that when we all check our emails pretty regularly, I think.
Yeah, I'm fine with that.
So the proposed ballot question would read, and it's on this one, shall the City of Dacono Home Rule Charter be amended to incorporate an open government policy, require council members and members of boards and commissions to attend periodic training regarding open government, include requirements for open meetings, notices, and agendas, provide that special meeting notices may be delivered to council members by email, limit discussion and formal action at meetings to items included on meeting agendas, except when an emergency requires immediate action, and require disclosures when relatives of council members and members of boards and commissions appear before such bodies. So that's roughly how it would read on the ballot to describe what's above.
So Kathleen, if you work on ordinances for any of this, do you need specific and detailed feedback tonight? Or how, because we don't have much time.
Right. So I will draft the ordinances and include them on the agenda for first reading at the next meeting. You know, you can make changes before you adopt them on first reading. You can also make second reading amendments when you have second reading. So there's lots of opportunities.
Okay, good. As long as there's lots of opportunities to refine this and get it just the way it needs to be so that we don't have any unexpected loopholes or gotchas or anything in there like that. Yeah.
Am I reading stuff to you guys that you're reading on your own right now?
What's that?
So am I reading stuff you guys are reading on your own right now? That's part of the packet or?
Well, why don't we zero in on some of this stuff is just like changing treasurer to director of finance. We can skip some of that stuff. But there's one here. This is in section 7-7. And this is council may by resolution appoint a city manager to serve at the pleasure of the council. The appointment or removal of the city manager shall require a resolution of council adopted by at least 4 affirmative votes. You do see that in the charter where the charter says, look, to do this particular thing, you need a resolution. You can't just do it by a simple motion because it's momentous. It needs discussion. Yeah, it needs discussion. It has serious implications. Yeah. And so what this does, it adds one more example of something in the charter that requires a resolution. And there's things that require ordinances too. So the charter details all that. So this just adds, it doesn't make everything have to be done by resolution. It just says there's one more example of something that needs to be done by resolution. And that's the hiring and firing by city council.
And also in this number 2 is a question I would like some feedback on tonight. There's the alternate ballot question to conform city charter to current administrative structure. It's at the top of page 5. You know, currently in the charter.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I skipped that, didn't I?
Yeah. No, it's all part of number 2.
Okay.
So if you go, it's past 7-7 where you were at. You didn't skip past it.
Oh, I didn't skip it. Okay, good. All right.
Yeah, so currently in the charter, as you see in the language in 7-6B, the city council appoints and removes the city clerk, director of finance, police chief, public works director, and each department director for any other departments established by the city council. Administratively, that's not the way your city functions. You have a city manager who has responsibility over all of the departments. And, you know, so this section of the charter is really, it's a symbol of the fact that your charter is now 30 years old almost. And the way your city operated back when the charter was adopted was very different. You didn't always have a city manager. And so council had a much more hands-on role in the administration of the city, and that's not the way the city functions now. And from a liability standpoint, I would counsel you that you don't want to be involved in the day-to-day. And so the question is, would you like to, and I think it's important to think about the city manager recruitment process that you're embarking on right now. And a city manager who is seriously considering coming to work for the city of Dacono will review your charter, and they will see that they really don't have control over the people that they are expected to supervise. And that, frankly, may cause some good candidates not to apply for the job. So it's really a question of how do you want your city to function? You know, it's functioning now with a manager that has supervisory and administrative control over the departments. If that's the way you'd like to keep it, then the charter should be amended.
So,
well, Councilmember Long, with all due respect, that's exactly what I just described, what you just said. So the question is, how would you, council, like for your charter to read? How would you like for your city to function?
Well, okay, so. So.
Okay. Yeah, so you have an open mind, Danny. Appreciate that.
So the pros and cons, right? The thing that I would say against changing this is that if there's a director or whatever that the city council would like to remove for cause, obviously for cause if it's a director, and the city manager does not want to take action, if we struck this all out, then the only thing we have left is the nuclear option, which would be to tell the manager either do it or you're out, right? I mean, that's kind of how it goes, right? But in this case, this is kind of antiquated. It's not how we have ever really operated. Directors have come and gone, right? We city council has never fired a director.
Right. All of your directors have been here for a very long time.
Yes. Or.
So what this essentially cleans up is that I think that department heads who were appointed by council and serve at council leisure, as does the city manager, gives the city manager direct supervision over them to where it wasn't this kind of understanding before. Because I think that's kind of what that's how we operated, was they were department heads and so was he. So they kind of followed his lead, but I think ultimately you're saying this would clean up that.
Well, the council expected the city manager to supervise and control the departments, to do performance evaluations, and all of that. But that's not what your charter reflects of the administrative function of your city.
Right. The city manager doesn't have teeth to really force directors to do as the manager wants. Because
right.
If you don't ultimately have hiring and firing control over somebody, they're on their own to do what they want.
And your performance review means very little.
Correct.
Right. And so the way it would operate, the way it has been operating in the city, is that the city manager is accountable to the city council for the administrative efficiency of the city. If the city council has issues with that, that's an issue to be taken up with the city manager, not department heads. And you already have an ordinance that talks about how council members don't involve themselves in the administrative affairs of the city. So it's consistent with that. And it's also consistent with how, in reality, the city has been functioning.
I agree. So, I mean, if the city manager is unhappy with the department head, he would come to council and probably lay out a case for us.
The thing is, Kathy and Tony are not here tonight, and I want them to, right? We want them to have input. And
we have two more readings.
Yeah, exactly.
This is just a discussion tonight.
What I was thinking, if we do write up an ordinance to have for first reading, maybe it just gets rejected that night or gets modified or whatever. But tonight it's pretty harmless to just write up an ordinance for this. Can we write the ordinance? Well, I guess when it gets to first reading, we can pick it apart, right?
Right, and I can prepare two versions of this ordinance that the council can choose which direction that they would like to go in.
Yeah, I think that would be good so that we have options.
Sure.
That is correct, Councilmember Long. That is a proposed amendment. I never said that it does.
What she's proposing is a change to what we currently have, to where it requires a resolution to terminate the city manager.
Yeah, Danny? It's a proposed.
And I support this wholeheartedly because I don't want to get back in the mess that we've been in for 5 months. I am, Danny. Thank you. Doing your job, Danny. Danny, doing your job. Hey, hang on. Doing your job requires all the council working together as a body, not four people going rogue. That's the problem.
That's why we're in the mess we're in.
Yeah.
So, you know, you said your piece, I'm saying my piece. This is cleanup. So this stuff doesn't happen again.
Can I re-clarify the idea of the process of resolution? You have four voted in. Resolution means that it could be vetoed by you, the mayor.
Correct.
In which case, if everybody but the mayor felt differently, we could also overturn your decision with
correct.
Five votes.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes.
Okay. So it doesn't really change who has the power to do what. It just...
Correct. It just would require five. Is,
if the ability to use a simple motion can be used to do huge, momentous things, it takes the executive power away from the mayor, and the mayor has a right to veto such things. It's just, that's the way it should be. That's how it, anyway, I'm gonna get off my box.
I just want to make sure, I heard it was giving mayor total power, which it's still not.
No, it does not. It just says that now it takes five instead of four. So if the council's wish is to get rid of them and there's five or six of you, then he's gone despite my veto.
Mayor, how many times have you vetoed anything?
Once.
There you go. Shall we continue?
Okay.
I think the next section,
heavily underlined section. We got other stuff to do as well, so there's people been waiting here for hours.
Isn't the next one the subsection four, all the heavily underlined area?
Yeah.
The next big change, I think.
Three is basically letting the city buy election equipment without having to go through the council, which I think is a smart thing to do.
Where's that one at?
Actually, number three is just the security of the voting equipment
security,
and materials.
You're right, sorry.
Yeah, it requires the clerk to restrict access to her and those performing election-related duties.
Oh, wait, we skipped something. 7-7-4. That's a big change right there. Do you want me to explain that one?
Which one?
No.
Which one, Kevin? Sorry.
You go ahead.
Okay, so this is 7-7, subsection 4 is being proposed that during the period of employment, or sorry, during the period of appointment, the city manager shall not be an employee of or perform any services for compensation from any person or entity other than the city or hold any elected or appointed office unless the manager has first obtained the approval of the city council, provided, however, the city manager may serve in a leadership role of any professional organization of which the city or the city manager is a member, as long as such activity is not contrary to the interest of the city. In simple terms, it says a city manager works for us, they're not moonlighting, and they're not elected to some other body somewhere else.
Well, we're not reinventing the wheel here either. This is part of many cities' charters that your primary employment has to be with the city.
And that is a clause that you will see in other charters.
Hmm. Removes conflict of interest.
Correct.
Yeah. All right. Sorry. We can go on to the next one now. I just want to make sure we didn't skip any pieces.
Yeah. So number four, just if we can quickly get past this one. This one came from your city clerk. We used to conduct our own elections in Dacono, and so results were certified rather quickly. And so... the newly elected council members were sworn in at the next meeting that followed the election. Now that the city coordinates with Weld County, it just takes a little bit longer to receive the certified results. So this just clarifies that elected officials take office at the first meeting, regular or special, following certification of the results of the election.
That's fine. Could we add, I'm fine with that. Could we add one more thing? Could we make sure that local elections that are ballots are also in Spanish? Can we add that?
I would get the input from your city clerk before we put that on. And she's not here tonight.
Yeah. We've had very few municipal elections.
It's extremely rare.
Probably since the 90s.
Yeah, it's very rare. But so, I would like to...
Can we take that up?
Yeah, take that offline with Val. That'd be fine.
Yeah, and I'll let Val know that you have that interest, and so she can look into that and give the council some real feedback on
The logistics
of that.
It.
Yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
That would be great.
I'm just thinking we can only get so much on there where people are going to be saturated.
I know, but it is topical to that.
Right, yeah. It is. So three is restricting access to council from areas where ballots may be stored. That seems like a no-brainer.
That's a no-brainer to me. And then the next one, there's some changes from mayor pro tem.
Yep.
And I think that's it. So we're down to the last changes. To everyone's relief here.
Basically says that the pro tem shall serve at council's discretion, leisure. This was, I thought, not clear in our charter, which is a lot of things are not clear in our charter from time to time. You kind of learn as you go, but, you know, it says a one-year term, but it doesn't say that that term cannot be completed by somebody else either. But this just clarifies that language, in my opinion.
Well, if you think about it, the mayor pro tem is selected from the council by the council.
Correct.
And if, you know, let's say, you know, we have a big, you know, let's say the mayor pro tem resigns or leaves council or we have a change in council. I mean, it does seem to make sense. I think this just kind of reinforces the fact that the mayor pro tem can be changed. Just like, mayor, you could take me off of planning commission if you wanted in a heartbeat. And the council could do it too.
One thing I know it's been discussed in a bunch of council meetings, and I asked Jen last week, so maybe she can speak to this too. But we've had a lot of people say they'd like to have a library district here, and I think it might be a good time to put that before voters if that's something we can put together. I understand there's some complications because we have to have kind of an understanding with the district before we can even really put it on the ballot, but. Well, I reached out to Jen to see if maybe she could reach out and get us some information. I don't know if you've met with them or heard back from them at all.
I actually have a meeting with the executive director Wednesday to discuss. It does involve an MOU between the city and the district establishing what that service looks like, as well as a resolution approving placing it on the ballot, and then eventually an IGA with the district also. So there are a handful of steps.
Could we put on the ballot with just an MOU, at least
a resolution?
Yeah, it's
since it's not a charter amendment, you can refer it by resolution. Charter amendments to be referred by ordinance.
Interesting. Okay.
So we can enter an understanding with them, but we can't join the district without it being on the ballot because then we're taxing people.
Right. It has to be voter approved.
Do we have time?
Well, I have a meeting set up Wednesday with, like I said, with the district. I don't know how fast an MOU could be approved by both entities. I think Dacono could get it approved pretty quick. I'm not so sure about the library district. That said, we have a template from the 2018 attempt. So perhaps things haven't changed that much that Matt and I could both look at it and feel comfortable with it and take it to our respective bodies for approval.
Okay. We won't know until your meeting then.
Correct.
Okay.
But I will provide an update to council.
Thank you. Anything else, guys, on this one?
I'm exhausted.
I know. So
we got one more item.
Up next is so I'm going to go ahead and executive session. I move that we move into executive session for the purposes of determining
Mayor,
position.
Yes. Do you want to do staff reports before
executive session? Oh, yes. Thank you for reminding me. You asked me that earlier. I'm getting tired.
I think we have a lot of people that want to go home.
I know. I'm sorry. You asked me that earlier, and I neglected it. Sorry.
Thank you. I'll be very quick with those reports. Just a reminder, your CERSA training on ethics, liability, and best practices for elected officials is Wednesday evening in this room. Although it is a study session, the public is certainly welcome to attend, and we will record the study session for those council members that are unable to attend. There is no Planning and Zoning Commission tomorrow evening. As a reminder, National Night Out is August 1st at Clem Dufour Park. It's going to be another exciting event with barbecue, movies, live music, etc. So if you're able to attend, it begins at 6 p.m. There will not be an urban renewal meeting in August. We will convene again in September. Dacono Music and Spirits is less than 2 weeks away, and there are volunteer opportunities still remaining. We'll be perhaps getting you your packets, t-shirt, and all the final schedule within the next week for that event. The city has a surplus of rec passes to the Carbon Valley Rec Center, and we want to make those available to the city council. Once they're used up, we'll really look for direction from the council if that is something you would like to continue purchasing. The Dacono Resident Survey is going to kick off next month. This is the national benchmark survey regarding local government satisfaction. The city has participated in this survey in 2015 and 2018. Due to COVID, it was delayed in 2020. We had hoped to start this in March, but obviously it was delayed. This was already budgeted and it was paid for 2023, which is why we're trying to get this going here real quick. Residents will receive a postcard in late August or September, followed by the survey and then a reminder card. There's an online option to complete the resident survey, and we also did pay for Spanish translation for the resident survey. The survey will be mailed to all households in Dacono, and we should have results in November. Val asked me to mention that nomination petitions for the November 2023 election will be available starting Tuesday, August 8th. There are two city council seats with three-year terms that end in November of 2026. So please contact Val for more information or look on the city website. We just discussed the library inclusion, and again, I'll just provide council a summary with that meeting and proposed timeline. And then Commander Fitch has a report regarding the assisted listening device.
Evening, council. Thank you. Have a preliminary proposal from Ford AV for the assisted listening devices. Basically, the scope of it would be 5 over-the-ear hearing devices that they could put over their ear. It would work in conjunction on top of a hearing aid. They can still use that. There's also providing 3 neck loop lanyards, and in that would be devices on those lanyards that would allow anyone who has a hearing aid with that technology of hearing aids now to Bluetooth into that, so they would be able to use their hearing aid. On top of that would be a 12 unit drop-in charging station that would be kept here. The whole server, it would go in the server room. It would be a receiver and then a antenna that would broadcast about 400 feet circumference of this area. The other part is, and the preliminary would be, sorry, I gotta get to that page. The estimate that they gave us was around $10,458. That's the base. If we did a 2-year extended warranty, it adds another $1,837 to it. And if we did a 3-year warranty, it adds $3 more to that. So it'd come out to $1,840. So the question is, do you guys want us to still proceed and keep moving forward on this to get something more solid and in place with Ford AV to move forward on this?
Why are we buying these?
I'm sorry?
Why are we buying these?
It is for anyone who has the hearing, who can't hear, people in the audience. With hearing aids, they may have them cranked, turned clear up. That may be something that they're not able to hear. Or if they don't have hearing aids, to be able to be in the crowd and be able to put that device on and be able to hear. And then the technology there to have anyone who does have a hearing aid that might not be able to hear it, they can actually borrow one of the receivers, check it out, and then that would Bluetooth with some of the newer hearing aids with the Bluetooth technology.
So I understand what you're asking for. So would this come back as a budget amendment? What is it, or the expense, is it small that we don't really we can just put it on the consent agenda? How's that? I don't know how that would work.
What we wanted to do, the request was made by Councilmember Long to look into an assisted hearing device. So we contacted AV Ford. There are other uses beyond just Councilmember Long using this device, municipal court as an example. It's an expenditure that will require city council approval. So we wanted to just provide an overview of the expenditure. If you can give us a head nod, yes, come right back with a resolution. So, we'll do that next month.
So anybody in this room,
correct,
would benefit. I like it. I like it a lot.
And like she said, it wouldn't be just for council. It'd be for court. We do host training here. So if we had training or anyone who hosts training here, those devices would be available for anybody who would need that.
Yeah, I mean, especially if somebody is here for court, they have a right to hear.
Correct.
So I like it a lot.
Could that be something that could be used, for example, as we had a translator today? For me, like, it's important that people can stay and listen to the meeting. I saw that the translator just came and translated what they were asking. Usually, like, at the other places I've been, they do headphones as well. So they have the translator kind of sit in the back and kind of do the whole, as people are speaking or what's being, that's being translated to them through the headphones. Is that something that could be adapted to that? Or if we look into getting those as well, I don't know exactly when we would be able to talk about this. Is this something we talk about now? I don't know.
So sure. As far as the system, no, that would be actually integrated into the system that is currently being used now. In order to do anything for Spanish translation, that would be a separate system you'd have to add, and then have it'd be operating separate from this system that we're currently talking on right now.
So if we were to have a person that was Hispanic or non-English speaking and they had a hearing aid, would that be able to accommodate them as well or no?
No, it does not translate. Again, that would actually be a separate system that would have to go in. Because what this was doing is it's basically taking what we're talking right now through this whole integrated sound system. They would integrate that in and it would transmit what we're saying here, but it doesn't do a translation in any other language.
I'm saying it wouldn't, I know it wouldn't do it, but let's say if the translator were to come in, because I would really like to look into, if you guys can look into having that translator here for 2 hours, for example, but she's translating that whole.
It would be a separate system that they would have to install. And I don't know that cost. That would be something that we'd also have to talk to them about, because that would be a separate system to communicate different earpieces, different system that will broadcast from a translator that you'd have to have on site doing the translation. Mm-hmm. That would be separate from this system. This system is merely to enhance the system that we already have installed. A translation service and system would be a total separate cost.
Okay.
Maybe it's something we can look into at some point in time, if it's feasible. Okay. The translation.
Yeah, the translation.
Yes, we'll look into that.
I'm okay with it.
But with respect to this issue, if you could just kind of give us a head nod if you'd like us to come back with a resolution.
Okay, sorry.
Thank you.
Yeah,
that's okay.
I would.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
I would.
I believe Kelly has a quick report. And then that's it for us.
You should have in front of you a couple pieces of paper. One was just a quick memo to let you know of an occurrence that happened during a power outage. unbeknownst to us, it kind of destroyed one of our servers. So we are in dire need of getting that server up and running and replaced. So we are invoking the emergency purchasing policy so that Timberland can go ahead and order the parts, because it will take us a little bit. And in the meantime, they're limping the server along and we're just hoping that it it holds up until they get the necessary parts to make the replacement. So I just wanted to let you know about that. It's about $35,000. That is kind of our going cost for the, our servers. We've had one other one rebuilt this year and a new server installed last year, same exact cost. So there's no big change in cost or anything like that, but it's unfortunately wasn't budgeted. So we will have to find the funds somewhere, but we need to go ahead and get that done so we don't lose any of our vital information. And we will notify you on the next bill packet that that the hardware has been purchased already.
Seems like we need a better backup cooling system to go with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Something like that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anything else, Jen? Sorry. Before we go into executive session, I'm actually the one that asked Jen to put on the her report about the passes. So the city bought approximately 500 rec passes, I think several years ago or longer. They expire. I did talk to the board, and they since we're an entity and we're not an individual, they're allowing them to just stay good in perpetuity. However, nobody's using them. So I wanted to put it to council to see if you'd be okay with not only city employees and council, but also families being able to use some of those passes. Because all they need is just a letter from Jen saying yes. So this is not something we have to vote on. It's not a resolution. The ones are purchased. They've been sitting there for years and are not being used. So if you or your families might use them, or staff or their families might use them, I think we should try to use them and let them sit.
Is there any? Are there like
single-use passes? Yeah. So it could take years to use the 500 we already own right now before we even look at the purchasing some more. And I think you said the cost was very small to purchase the passes. So I guess this is a head nod thing again. I'm okay with it.
Yeah,
I'm good with it.
We're okay with that too.
Okay. All right, there you go. I think you just have to show up, Danny, and give them your ID, and they let you in if you're on the list. Okay, so where did I put my... Sorry. I started putting stuff away. It's here somewhere, hang on. I move that we move into executive session for the purposes of determining positions relative to matters that may be subject to negotiations, developing strategy for negotiations, and or instructing negotiators under CRS 246-4024E, and for a conference with the city attorney for the purpose of receiving legal advice on specific legal questions under CRS 246-4024B, specifically concerning KPK Financial Assurance.
Second.
Good vote, please, Lisa.
Doris Crespo.
Yes.
Michelle Rogers.
Yes.
Kevin Plain.
Yes.
Danny Long.
Yes.
Okay. With all council voting yes, we'll move into executive session.
Just real quickly, Danny, as a reminder, you will have a separate Zoom login for the executive session. So please make sure you log out of this Zoom meeting and into the executive session.
Lisa, I have that list.